Or representative from.
Yeah, whoever.
Yeah.
Because sometimes it's not going to have that nice to be.
All right, just send anyone.
Perfect.
Can take an answer. Or get us answers. Either one.
Okay, good morning. Well, it's afternoon. It feels like morning still. Good afternoon. I'd like to call this meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works together for Tuesday, April 14th. Live streaming. We're live streaming people, so hello to everyone we're live streaming to. I'd like to introduce members of my committee. I've got Councillor Sharma, Councillor Dobson, and Councillor Gilroy. Members of administration are here also. Some councillors that will be coming forward, and our clerks. Thank you. I'd like to ask for a motion to approve meeting minutes held on March 16th, 2015.
So moved, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Now, delegations. Let's start with delegations.
All those in favor?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay.
We do have two that need suspension of the rules in order to be heard as we register today.
Okay. So we'll suspend the rules as we proceed?
Yep.
Okay. Okay. Delegations. Councillor Bruati, North Kildonan Ward, to be heard with respect to the East St. Paul Thorough Pass, which is item number
seven. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, members of the committee. I'd like to start off by passing out a thank you to the public service for the fast turnaround time on this particular report. First of all, again, this report makes very clear what to me seems like common sense. The local streets within the North Kildonan ward are not really set up to accommodate the additional traffic that this potential through pass would bring if it was open to general vehicular traffic. As part of the whole perimeter Highway 59 interchange project that the province of Manitoba is doing, there was discussion, and going back to a 2011 provincial election promise, to build an active transportation crossing to connect the Northeast Pioneers Greenway on into East St. Paul and through to Birds Hill Park. I don't think anyone really had a concern. I mean, with the idea of the AT bridge going over the perimeter highway. It's an expensive touch, but I think we've all been impressed by the number of people that have taken up the usage of the Northeast Pioneers Greenway and the healthier lifestyles associated with active transportation. This whole thing has morphed, though, into something quite a bit more involved and quite different. The new proposal, first of all, raises the perimeter highway up into the air. Typically, when you have a large, major highway-type road like this, you need to do extensive sound attenuation. Residents in the area, whether they're in East St. Paul or into the city of Winnipeg, haven't seen any plans as to what kind of sound attenuation would be provided for a highway literally being moved up into the air to accommodate an at-grade vehicular emergency and active transportation. They call it a through pass. I'm calling it a tunnel because it's basically a tunnel. Going through, four lanes of highway, center median, as well as extensive shoulders. The Minister of Provincial Transportation says extensive consultation has been done. In terms of the sound attenuation, there's been absolutely nothing provided to the public that I have been made aware of in any way. The whole notion of additional protection for fire, first of all, ambulance services are already provided inside the perimeter highway from the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Service. Paramedic services inside the perimeter highway within the arm of East St. Paul are already coming from Winnipeg facilities, is my understanding. I told the previous mayor of East St. Paul, I mentioned to the current mayor of East St. Paul in November, I mentioned to the previous Minister of Infrastructure Transportation, Steve Ashton, I would do whatever I could to advocate very, very strongly at this council to provide a very reasonable term in terms of service sharing for fire protection, either on a primary or secondary basis, inside the perimeter highway to East St. Paul. If you didn't build this vehicular piece, whether it's for emergency vehicles or for regular general traffic, there's certainly an opportunity you know, to continue using East St. Paul fire protection as they do today. They don't typically use this crash sheets that are at Raleigh today. They could still use their route, which is typically today on Henderson or Lagimodier. But in the event of a catastrophic type issue, secondary protection could be provided from the Winnipeg Fire Hall located at Rothesay and McIver. And again, I offered to all those three parties, the previous mayor, the current mayor, and the former minister of MIT, the opportunity of exploring a service sharing agreement in the city. Again, that's still need council approval, but again, it seems like more common sense and a more collaborative and cooperative way to work on an issue like this rather than spending scarce tax resources on a tunnel that's virtually never going to get used. Again, the comments that I've made in the media haven't been about mass annexation. I've been very careful. I've been quoted in stories that have talked about annexation, but stories where I've talked about extending the city's boundaries have been far more related to, the idea that residents in East St. Paul are expressing their frustration to me that their council wasn't listening to them, and they have issues with the idea of a vehicular opening there as well, or with a big box retail center, and they felt that their council was being their previous council, to be clear, was not being as responsive as they'd like. So again, I'm happy to see this report, and going forward, I hope we can find a more collaborative way to deal with the province, because again, we haven't been, the city proper had not been properly consulted on this matter. I do have a meeting coming up in the coming weeks with the current Minister of Infrastructure Transportation, and I'll certainly be passing on this report to him at that time. So I would ask that the committee receive this as information and endorse it, I suppose. And the report will be going forward to EPC and council.
Okay. Do committee members have any questions of Councillor Baratti or comments? Councillor Sharma.
Thank you, Councillor Baratti, for appearing today. So you essentially agree with the report in front of us?
I do. And again, the request was just to get the public service's opinion on the idea of a vehicular opening. Again, the public service is, you know, completely supportive of the active transportation and potentially the emergency component. Mm-hmm. Again, if we wanted to go to a service sharing agreement, that would be something political and not necessarily within the realm of what I'd expect the public service to recommend.
So we are very concerned, I see, about the 30,000 vehicles per day that would be passing through this.
I think 30,000 is a really high number. I think, you know, that was a number, though, that was first brought up at a municipal board hearing last fall by the transportation consultants from East St. Paul. Those aren't numbers that are made up. My, you know, best guess is that number is high anyway. And I do believe it was based on a four-lane scenario. Again, it's speaking of, you know, collaboration and stuff, just this past March of 2014, the partnership with Manitoba Capital Region, which includes all of the Capital Region municipalities, is working with M&M and MIT, Manitoba Infrastructure Transportation of the province, finalized a Capital Region transportation plan, and nowhere did they include the idea of using the Raleigh Gateway Corridor as a interjurisdictional or a new crossing.
So if there was an accident on 59 Highway and at the intersection, how would the emergency vehicles on the north side of the perimeter get into the city?
Sorry.
At the intersection.
At 59 and 101?
Yeah.
Okay.
On the north side. Happened on the north side.
Those are the East St. Paul crews responding to that.
And how would the emergency vehicles get, let's say, the accident victims into the city? How do they do that now?
How do they do it today? Mm-hmm. My understanding is typically they would use the roads that are there today, Lagimodier or Henderson Highway.
Mm-hmm. Or they go to Henderson Highway.
Yeah, but the perimeter highway that links the two.
So this isn't a tunnel, it's an at-grade crossing. Like, it's completely at grade. It's the bridge that's raised.
So the whole perimeter highway for a fairly lengthy stretch would be up in the air. That's
right. So it's not a tunnel at all. Like, it's at grade. It's an under. It goes underneath.
But it's quite long. It's going to be like a tunnel.
Well.
The diagrams to me look like a tunnel. The ones that they presented at, when they showed it as just being an emergency piece, I bet 9 people out of 10 would say that it's a tunnel. Mm-hmm.
So you're comfortable, though, with the two-lane road, the way it is, being used only as emergency use?
Again, I think it's far better uses of money rather than doing that. I would be fine if they still built the open and visible active transportation bridge. I'd be okay with that. I don't know if it's necessarily the best use of money, but I'd be fine with that. But I don't think an at-grade crossing is the best way for active transportation. And in terms of the emergency access piece, I think there's far more prudent ways of providing proper emergency services to residents in East St. Paul, south of Perimeter Highway, at a far more responsible cost.
But this report is saying, from my understanding from the administration, is it's fine. They're fine as long as the road is used for emergency use.
A lot of people,
right? And you're in agreement with that? I mean, you're in agreement with the report, so that's what the report is saying.
A lot of people are concerned that if they build it, it's going to be wide enough to handle general vehicle traffic as well. We don't really have...
For the future, you're saying?
For the future. There's concern that at some point it could be open to general vehicle traffic. And in fact, the piece that my understanding is East St. Paul Council has only agreed sort of in principle to this whole piece. And you know what? With all respect, you know, I do appreciate that if it ever were to be opened, this would be the time to tie that in. I just don't think that tying this in is appropriate. There's other ways to improve traffic flow for the RM.
That's a discussion with the province. Like, what's in front of us today is there's two lanes that are going at grade level under the perimeter that are going to be used only for emergencies.
Being responsible, I mean, you need to make sure that a secondary emergency access is available to East St. Paul side of the Perimeter Highway. Again, we're only talking about... Is it 150 or 300 homes? I have to double check. Plus new properties coming on stream and countryside crossings. It's not a super large area. Whether it's a flat retainer rate to provide secondary coverage from the city or on an on-call basis, the cost of this would be a fraction of what the capital costs are going to be for this tunnel. If they went every week, it would probably
But the report in front of us really isn't talking about how the province is choosing to spend their money. Maybe the province is choosing to spend their money for the capital region, for future expansion for the capital region, which would be really wise.
Sure.
And it would be really wise for the city to start planning for the capital region and accommodating the growth in the capital region.
And we have a plan that the capital region adopted last year. To deal with the growth in the whole capital region, not just in the north, but around the whole area.
Right.
This was not part of that plan, and I still don't think that this is, it still doesn't make sense.
Yeah, but your points are more to the province, so not to the report here. You're completely fine with the report. It's two lanes. The city administration says, perfect, no problem, we'll use it as emergency. So your problem's more with the province on how they're spending the money versus what the city and the report is.
I think we have an opportunity politically to now work with the province and our neighbors in East St. Paul to provide that secondary emergency coverage without building a tunnel or an at-grade crossing or whatever you want to call it.
All right. Okay, great.
Okay, thank you.
Perfect. Okay. All right. Thank you, Councillor Barotti. Mr. Saunders. Mr. Saunders, item number five, report number five. You'll state your name and address. And item number five is the single source negotiations and award of contract for Manitoba Hydro Works. Okay.
Madam Chair, my name is David Saunders, and I'm appearing as a private citizen to make a brief submission in opposition to report number five. This is the single source negotiations and award contract for Manitoba Hydro Works associated with the Colburn Calrossi Combined Sewer Area Land Drainage Improvements Projects, the Parker Pond Bid Solicitation 190-2015. I don't believe there was a bid solicitation not published. And of course, you're recommending a single source in this case. It's very hard to follow the money for this scheme, which is sometimes an integral part of the Southwest Transit boondoggle, and sometimes not. The proposed $4,050,000 budget for relocating the Manitoba Hydro lines and towers in the vicinity of the proposed Parker Retention Pond is not part of the Transitway budget. And so far, I don't see any estimate of the cost of undertaking the Colburn-Calrossi combined sewer area land drainage improvements project. When staff were asked what that cost was at a previous meeting, they didn't have an answer, and I don't see one here in the report today. We are told this project is a separate project from the Southwest Transitway Stage 2, so it's not part of the Transitway land drainage works estimated to cost $39.9 million out of the $590 million estimated project total for the Transitway and Pembina Highway upgrade. Instead, I take it that the Colburn-Calrossi project will consume some unknown amount of the $27.2 million remaining in the entire combined sewer overflow and basement flood management strategy project for the inner city. It does appear to me that there should be, there should have been, a major project steering committee and quarterly financial status report for this project, which is apparently $70.1 million in total. In any event, the environmental review and assessment report, which was submitted by the city's consultants to the province last year, which again has never ever been referred to or shown on city website materials, nevertheless, that report stated clearly that the Parker Retention Pond is, quote, not part of the Stage 2 of the Southwest Transitway project. In my opinion, the city does not have an environmental license to construct the proposed retention pond, nor to relocate the hydro towers and lines. Furthermore, the conditional license, because it is conditional, which has been issued for the Southwest Transitway, has in fact been appealed to the minister, and he has not yet rendered a decision on the request for referral of the matter to the Clean Environment Commission for a public hearing. Actually, it appears that the rush to construct the Parker Retention Pond reflects the fact that the city may in fact have violated or be in violation now of condition number 8 of its other environmental license, number 3042, for combined sewers and overflow, by in fact having permitted the new development to take place on the Taylor lands without any on-site storm drainage, which was originally expected there. Today's report admits that the so-called deep retention pond option now recommended takes into consideration the proposed development of unserviced lands on Taylor Avenue and the Parker lands. And that appears to be the primary objective of the exercise. This is just one more financial commitment, which in my view the city should hold off until the route and the justification for the transitway scheme are properly reviewed by the new council. Thank you for listening this morning. Back to you.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions of Mr. Saunders or comments?
Very good information as per normal. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I will have, when it comes up on the agenda, we'll talk, the $70.1 million, that is a budget, to my understanding, that the city holds for overflow and basement flood management, and that this funding is coming from that budget. It's not the project budget, but we'll get clarification on that later. But it's not a project for 70.1. My understanding is that it is a budget that's used for situations like we're dealing with here that's related to ponds, stormwater, and such.
Which, from where I sit, appears to be happening without much oversight by council. So
that you're talking about that budget then. You're saying that capital budget is...
It's in the budget, yes.
Okay, that's a valid point. And then the other thing I'm going to confirm too, my understanding is environmental licenses is in the works. So I'll confirm that also.
Well, the environmental, which one? The environmental license for?
For the pond, for the whole.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
It doesn't appear yet on the public registry, so I take it hasn't been applied for yet.
Okay.
But Mount Abba Hydro is presumably going to apply for it.
Okay. We'll confirm that when the item comes up. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. See report number 5. Andrew Swanson to be heard with the 2015 Capital Local Street Renewals, Alley Renewals, TVOs, and Granular Roadway Improvements. Report 17. Got it. Okay. Perfect.
and you have a presentation.
Oh, sweet.
Mr. Swanson.
Thanks, everybody, for having me. So I'm here in a couple capacities. I'm going to start off as the coordinator of the Winnipeg Trails Association, and I'll just tell you a little bit about us. I'm here to speak about the street renewals and back lanes, that big budget that you're set to look at today. And I'm trying to go full screen. You can probably all see it. There you go. Just as by way of introduction, so Winnipeg Trails Association is, I'm the chef d'équipe for a whole bunch of people who are working really hard to connect Winnipeg's trail system throughout the entire city. We've been around for over a decade working on things like the Bishop Barron Greenway, Transcona Trail, the Yellow Ribbon Greenway, the Hydro Trail in your ward. Trying to move the city forward towards a better family-friendly walking and biking environment. It's pretty simple. It's very, very happy, good, exciting stuff. We have a very small budget in the sense that we don't typically build the trails ourselves. Obviously, these are all City of Winnipeg assets. But we've worked extremely hard, both myself and the past coordinator, to make sure that the provinces and the city's priorities have aligned, to make sure that when things happen, opportunities that arise for the city don't get missed. So just to give you an idea of our success, if you had a look at this map, this is a screenshot today of the of Google Maps of the bicycle layer on. It's the sort of the quickest way to get a picture of the trails connectivity in Winnipeg. If you had a look at this map 5 years ago, it would be none of those dark green lines would exist, very few of them. So we've made leaps and bounds in the last little while in creating connectivity amongst our trails. The thing about trails is that every trail starts at home. So we aren't necessarily about that specific trail, we are about connectivity. And that means getting people to those places safely. So all those big lines, we're all quite proud of them, but the big lines are really only part of the story. I just got back into Winnipeg. I was living in the Netherlands for 2 months. And when I got back, I was in a little bit of a state of shell shock by the sort of environment that I was facing to grow up and raise my kids in. Partially because the walking and cycling environment here is relatively discontinuous. And that's okay, that's something that every North American city is basically facing. They're all working on it, from Calgary to Houston. They're putting in things like bike lanes downtown. They're putting in pedestrian countdown signals that you've seen on Portage Avenue and trying to change that. The reason people drive more than they walk or bike in Winnipeg is that picture. So that is our connected roadway network. And you'll notice the green ones, those are just the main ones that are jumping at you. The rest of them are designed primarily for cars, and they're the stuff that's in between, and that's the stuff that you're looking at today. So the little connections, your street, my street, street in front of your kid's school, street in front of my kid's school. So if you look back again, that's what the pathway network looks like. The walking network is a little bit different, but I don't have a map of it here. I've kind of prepared this a little bit quickly, but have a look at the sidewalk map of the city of Winnipeg just for fun sometime. Just have a look at it. It's very interesting. It reveals a lot. This is stuff that you're looking at today. So I didn't have time to look at every single project in detail, but I've been around long enough watching what we've done in Winnipeg to know that we have missed a lot of opportunities to make even simple improvements for walking and cycling. The kind of stuff that makes it easy for anybody of any age to get from home to wherever they need to go, quite simply. So, and there's a lot of us out there. So 42% of Manitobans, for example, don't drive a car. And that sounds crazy, but it's because probably lots of us do, and I do, and stuff like that. But everybody under 16 doesn't. A whole swath of adults don't. Lots of people, as they age, either can't or just decide that they don't feel like it anymore, because it's a little bit stressful. And what's happening is kind of this. and it's impacting our trails, especially at all of the connections where they meet roads, and especially for our users' ability to get to them. I'm sure you've heard of this concept before. Complete streets is pretty simple, but it's the idea that those are all the kind of things that need to use the road, and just so in that, you could very easily have a wheelchair in place of that person walking. You could very easily have a father with three kids in the back in a trailer in place of that bicycle. You could have a scooter, a motorcycle, but obviously a tram, but that's the spectrum of what we need to plan for. Transportation to me is a public utility. So that anywhere you do stuff only for cars, it's like building a neighborhood without electricity or water. For me it is because I prefer to bike. For little kids it definitely is because they can't drive. For elderly people it becomes extremely important. It's extremely important for transit as well. It's extremely important for trails. These are the two main people that I'm thinking about, because they're the ones who don't show up at these meetings, mainly because you don't offer pizza. And these people, because no matter what, whatever you think, we're all able-bodied, we're going to end up being them. So you better plan for them. This is kind of how we've been doing things. This is really how we ought to do them. So as long as we're all on the same page for that, let's talk about the mechanics of how that happens. So this, of course, is this is what they're doing downtown Calgary. Now, what does that have to do with trails? Well, how do you get from, for example, the Assiniboine, the Riverwalk, to MTS Centre to go see the Jets play, if you're walking or cycling? What happens when you have to cross Portage Avenue? What happens when you have to cross Broadway? Is it designed with the pedestrian in mind? Is it designed with the person on bicycle in mind? It's what I call, well, lots of people call, light infrastructure. And the problem with light infrastructure is that you have to really look down and notice to see it. It's not the Eiffel Tower, it's not the floodway, it's not the MTS Center, but it's extremely important to how we get around our city. So does anybody recognize this picture? Sorry, it's a rhetorical question. This thing I was presenting to little kids yesterday, it's different. Rhetorical question, does anybody recognize this? No, you don't. It's because we don't really have any of these in Winnipeg. And so when I know that this is about local streets, but I'm just going to talk about one example because it's nearby. You can go have a look. Go have a look at crossing Portage Avenue and think about what it's like for an 8-year-old person or an 8-year-old kid. And ask yourself, when we did the rehabs, I remember it because I worked downtown, I lived downtown, did a rehab on Portage Avenue. Why wouldn't it do that on Portage Avenue of all places in front of the MTS Center? So that's, I'm just going to leave that one example with you because that I think illustrates a lot. If we don't do this, what are we not doing in your neighborhoods on the local streets that are getting kids to their school, for example, or getting our users to our trails? Those are the kind of people that need to use it. And if you think the consequences are, you know, you can kind of forget about it because people can walk, do a Google search for pedestrians killed on Portage Avenue and see where they were killed. Just do it. I'm going to change hats, because I also am a transportation consultant. I've been working for the Green Action Center doing stuff with Safe Routes to School. And this is where we get to the local stuff. We just did a project where we had 17 participating schools, and we looked at in depth at how kids got to an individual school. We get phone calls all the time because there's basically the worst traffic in a typical neighborhood outside of the collector streets is around in the immediate area around a school at drop-off and pick-up time. If any of you have kids, you know this quite well. They're asked, help us do something about that. So what we did was, well, we looked at it, and we thought, well, how are kids getting to and from school? And we came up with these maps. Now, if you notice, that's the way the kids are getting by walking, by biking, by car, and by transit. Buses, in this case, for most part, because this is an elementary school. When we had engineering teams, and these are fourth-year engineering graduates, have a look at this, they came up with long lists of projects that needed to be done, tiny ones, but really, really important ones, kind of like $150,000 and below. Some were expensive. And all of those, the only time that we're ever going to get to do that is during the local street renewal projects. So I guess my general question is, what's going on in those projects, and are we doing it? So just to go back, that's what you're looking at. I have one request and two offers. The request is to be very, very careful that when you do a big swath of projects like this, that you know exactly what's going on. My offer is, I'll walk with you there. I'm kind of an expert in that, for whatever reason, and I can go there and I can explain to you what's going on, what are the things that could be done. It's very possible. Public Works has been growing by leaps and bounds since I've been here. Every city in North America has been learning really, really quickly. New planners, new engineers, they love this kind of stuff. They're becoming experts in it too. You can get that information. I wouldn't be surprised if some of them include some of this stuff, but I guarantee you that there's stuff missing. So be very, very careful as to whether or not those projects are in fact complete streets. And my other offer is you can borrow my bicycle anytime. I have lots of them. Just go for a bike ride because you'll learn most of what you need to know just by doing that. Thanks very much.
Okay, wait, we'll see. Does anyone have any questions? Councillor Sharma.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Anders, for your presentation today. What specific comments do you have about the report in front of us?
I had a quick look at it. I can give you three examples. One, for example, Vernell, Councillor Gilroy's ward, I believe. If you know Vernell, it's right on Greenwood School. There's the Orioles bike cage is there. DMSMCA is just up the corner. It comes from the grocery store on Portage. That street is amazingly wide. It would make a lovely cycle track, for example, a protected bike lane. And it would be cheap, it would be easy, and now would be the time to do it. So I ride that a lot because I volunteer at that little bike shop sometimes, and I know that area very well. That to me is a no-brainer. If it doesn't have one, there's an indication. Another good one is Hargrave back lane. And this is not related to transportation necessarily, but it's my back lane, actually. It's where I live. That back lane has people jetting through there to try and get home from work really quickly, and sometimes I say family-unfriendly things to the people who come through my back lane at speed. And I would just like to see that, for example, have the simple things that they would have in Europe, which is basically speed tables where people are approaching. And actually, I think you should probably have a mirror on the, stuff like that, stuff for being able to see and identify that the pedestrians are there. The other one that I'm thinking of, well, just have a look at all the ones where they connect to our trails, for example. And they're just detailed design stuff that, quite frankly, I don't know if it's in there. From most of the stuff that I've seen happen, you know, it hasn't shown up, and it won't show up for another 20 years if you miss the opportunity now. So I'm more than happy to spend all my time going and checking out all these ones individually and seeing what can or what are the opportunities with you and what could be done in those places.
Thank you. Are there any other questions of Mr. Swanson?
Oh, sorry, I had one last more. One last one. Edgewood. If you know Edgewood, if the councillor for St. Boniface isn't here. Edgewood connects to, I think, St. Boniface's only pedestrian and cycling bridge. Actually, there's another one way further south on Firmore. We recently redid that one as well. The approaches to it got better, but they could be a lot better. And definitely crossing Desmurons and Uville in those locations, if that is part of the scope of the project, is something that they need to look at. Just off the top of my head. Again, like I'm pretty good with the math, but I... This came out not long ago. I'd rather walk it through. You can see everything. Yeah.
Okay. So when the administration comes up, we'll ask them what they've done to look at the basically the walking and biking components of the roads, and we'll hear from them. Okay. So any other? That's it. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. All right. Okay, so Anthony left, Anthony Dratawani, to be heard respect to the Marin Avenue. And this is his. We'll just take a minute and look at it. Okay. That's to report number 11. Okay. Okay, and Mark Coho, what did he
submitted something he couldn't attend as well.
And where is that he submitted?
I sent an email to you.
You sent an email. Yeah. Okay, I'll just take a look at it. Okay, Mark, were you able to read Mr. Coho's in the email that he couldn't make it? So if you want to just take a minute on your screen and take a look and see what he's got to say. Regarding report number 17.
Okay.
That is
And then we have three further delegations that didn't register before 4:30 yesterday, so we need suspension of the rules. For Shelley Hart, Peter Kotick, and Councillor Wyatt.
Okay. Could we have a suspension? Can we have a motion, please?
So moved, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. All right. Mayor Shelley Hart. Report number 7 to be heard with respect to East St. Paul Thorough Pass. Good afternoon, Mayor.
Good afternoon. Chairperson Lukes and members of the Infrastructure Committee. I'm pleased to be here today to provide context to the decisions that Council will be asked to make, this Wednesday, relating to the Raleigh Street Level Grade Through Pass in East St. Paul. The province of Manitoba's construction of the 10159 interchange, which is in essence the completion of the perimeter highway at 59, is the catalyst for the through pass at Raleigh and the perimeter. East St. Paul and our direct neighbors in St. Clements and Springfield, which includes Oak Bank, utilize two main roadways in and out of Winnipeg, Highway 59 and Henderson Highway. East St. Paul's long-range transportation plans contemplated a third north-south route along Raleigh Street, but it had a very high level cost of about $20 million, a very high, low estimate. Having an opportunity to accomplish the same for $3 million, which was offered by the province of Manitoba, was an opportunity that East St. Paul could simply not ignore. The province of Manitoba provided East St. Paul with an exceptional opportunity to develop a new north-south transportation route between East St. Paul and the city of Winnipeg. The province of Manitoba had the foresight and understanding of the importance of this transportation link and subsequently made the offer to East St. Paul. The opportunity the construction project offered in terms of timing and cost was also significant. When East St. Paul Council was approached in November of 2014, we had 11 days to decide if we wanted to provide the province of Manitoba with a statement of agreement in principle around the concept of a two-lane through pass. As you're aware, they had already contemplated the AT pass as well as a lane for emergency vehicles. So this was adding a second lane of traffic which would accommodate vehicle traffic. Given the significant benefits to our community, as well as the other communities that surround us, and the cost savings that this option represented when compared to the other options that we had looked at for improved access, Council held a special meeting on the matter and voted unanimously to issue a statement of agreement in principle. The day after East St. Paul Council passed this resolution in November, I met with Councillor Broaddy and advised him of the resolution and why we had proceeded as we had. On January 6th, the letter was sent to Mayor Bowman outlining the info on the through pass resolution in great detail. In fact, the letter ends up mirroring what we posted on our website in February, which in great details identifies and describes the project and why we made the moves that we did. On February 6th, Mayor Bowman's office responded to my letter suggesting that I meet with Councillor Lukes and discuss the project and the province of Manitoba's project, which directly affects East St. Paul and the city of Winnipeg. Councillor Lukes and I did meet on March 9th, and it gave me the opportunity to discuss the project in greater detail and answer any questions that she might have. This is not a city of Winnipeg versus East St. Paul issue, and I think we need to be really clear about that. This transportation link will benefit both of us as well as the other municipalities in the area. The city of Winnipeg's vacant land is limited. We hear about, you know, the resources that are drying up in regards to land, and this will translate into more development outside the perimeter into the capital region. The capital region is the 16 municipalities that surround the city of Winnipeg and does include the city of Winnipeg. If traffic projections are reasonable in the long term, and based on the Conference Board of Canada's projection, how is the city of Winnipeg going to accommodate this regional growth that is going to happen in all corners of the city? In our corner, the Northeast region, the two main routes are Henderson Highway and Lagimodier Boulevard. Building the Raleigh through pass will in fact reduce traffic volumes on both Lagimodier and Henderson Highway, offering another north-south route for the capital region. Before I appeared here today, we did get some additional information from our traffic engineers, Stantec, who originally was the author of our 2008 transportation master plan. And we asked them a simple question. If the rally through pass was operational 3 years from today, so in concert with the completion of the 101-59 overpass, what would the traffic volumes look like when the day had opened? And Stantec used Housing Start estimates and the original transportation plan they put together, and those numbers would be simply 2,000 to 3,000 vehicles a day. The projections that we've heard in other venues are based on multi-years going out to 2030 and worst-case scenario of growth. I can tell you in East St. Paul, over the last, in the years from 1992 to 2007, so a 15-year span, we had an average of 71 housing starts per year. In the last 7 years, we have seen only 35 housing starts per year. So using the level projections that were used for the 30,000 number that was the basis of much of the concern that the day we open the through-pass traffic is going to be flooding into the city of Winnipeg, really are long-range, best, worst case, if you will, projections. But to reiterate, if we open that through-pass in 3 years' time, we would see no more than 2,000 to 3,000 vehicles a day. Today, I would like to ask this committee to reconsider the wording of their second recommendation to one which reflects a willingness to work in conjunction with East St. Paul in determining if and when vehicle traffic can be contemplated by both our municipalities. This was never a roadway which was going to be built by East St. Paul without consultation with the City of Winnipeg. East St. Paul simply provided the province of Manitoba with a statement of agreement in principle, so that the infrastructure to accommodate a roadway would be built in conjunction with the 101-59 interchange project which was going on. We are neighbors and we face many of the same challenges. Our residents expect us to work together in the best interests of all member municipalities in the capital region. Thank you.
Okay. Do we have any questions from any of the members? Any of the committee members? I have some questions. Councillor Sharma.
So, Mayor Hart, thank you for appearing today. You have an amendment you'd like to make to item number 2 in the recommendation?
Yes.
Yeah. What is the specific wording that you're
You want the specific wording? Well, I don't know if I would provide you with the exact wording, but I think the
spirit of what you're asking
of
for, if you could reiterate.
Not say that we don't support it at this time. I think not supporting it leaves you with... we haven't had the opportunity to sit down and have conversations, which was the next step contemplated by East St. Paul. And I think if that resolution was worded in a way that we say we each have a willingness to work in conjunction and that we want to sit down and look at the viability of this roadway and see if we can come to consensus and collaborate on the idea of the roadway as opposed to working in isolation of each other and disregarding it at this point. So I think that's the spirit. I could leave it up to you to come up with the wording which reflects that intent. So not to say right now that we want to say the idea is not viable for the City of Winnipeg, but to explore it and to work together to really see what the outcomes of this roadway would be. In a very short time, we were able to get an estimate, which really, I think, would reduce a lot of the anxiety. If people here, 2,000 to 3,000 people, are going to be using that roadway right away in a long-range plan, has a very different number. I think it puts it into a much greater perspective as to what's really going to happen. And open up the context, this is a capital region issue. This is not an East St. Paul versus City of Winnipeg issue. We have many municipalities that drive through East St. Paul every day to come into Winnipeg to work. Everybody on Henderson Highway north of East St. Paul, which is around Bowen Road, drive into the City of Winnipeg through Henderson Highway and Lajimodia Boulevard. People that about 40% of the residents of Oakbank use Highway 59 every day. These are capital region municipalities that are coming into the City of Winnipeg, regardless if we open up the Raleigh through pass. And what that does is gives another option for traffic to use, lessens the burden on the other two streets, which also impact the City of Winnipeg, and I think working together would be a much better methodology in looking at ways to move traffic in and around the capital region.
So right now, the report is saying basically that the roadway will go in and that it will be used only for emergency vehicles.
Correct.
And what's your thought on that?
We're very comfortable with that. That provides us another emergency access to the south side. Highway 101 virtually cuts our south part of East St. Paul off, so that gives us emergency access into the south side. It also adds to the active transportation. It's in the same location as the active transportation path. So what the province is really saying is, we're building an emergency access roadway for you already. They're committed to doing that for us. They understand the importance of that emergency access. So in the context of the larger project that they're doing, they were able to add on a smaller amount on the infrastructure that allows a second lane to be used for regular road traffic. So it's great foresight that they saw they didn't limit the project to basically an emergency access, because down the road, if both of our municipalities want to have another access through that area, this gives us the opportunity to do it at a much reduced cost. And if you look at the roadway and how the configuration is, it lines a Gateway Raleigh, if we use that kind of corridor. It lines up perfectly with the City of Winnipeg's Gateway Raleigh and continues right to Chief Peguis, which is one of the main arteries. So all the infrastructure, if you will, is already there, and all the province is asked to provide right now is that capacity. They're not building a roadway. They're merely adding the capacity on the through pass to accommodate a second lane for vehicle traffic should our two municipalities choose to go down that road.
And we will hear when administration comes forward what the current capacity is within the city to handle the volumes of traffic. I've heard your stats, and being involved with the Capital Region, you know, when I look to see the population of East St. Paul, they've projected for 2030 11,000 people. So, it's 30. I'm having a hard time thinking 30,000 vehicles when there's 11,000 people out there, even though that there's surrounding traffic and such. Anyways,
we're only at 90. The 2011 census has us at 9,900. I'm sorry, 9,000.
9,000.
So to see that kind of growth, and that's why I gave you the statistic of house starts that we had in East St. Paul. When we look at the formative 15 years from 92 to 07, we had 71 starts per year in East St. Paul. We have pretty much less than almost half of that at 35 over the last 7 years. So when that report, our master transportation plan, was originally used, and when they used the very worst case scenarios of traffic volumes, they were basing it on numbers which saw the previous 71 starts as an average. If you factor in the actual rates that we've seen in the last 7 years, it would be less than half. So I would have to conclude, just based on this smaller sample, that the estimates used were quite as a worst case scenario. The realities of it will be much less.
How would you feel about that road being used exclusively for a transit corridor, just a shuttle at some point? How do you think your community would respond to that?
I think anytime we look at any kind of transportation that reduces cars on roadways is an improvement, and there would be a lot of, I think, uptake on usage if it provided a reasonable and reliable level of transportation. I guess I can only say that I know some of the challenges around funding transit, and I would probably hesitate to think that we would have the ability to build a roadway and use that long before we would be able to have transit, which would accommodate it. But I think there's room for both, and would absolutely look to building on that kind of transportation hub. I think it would benefit East St. Paul as well as the City of Winnipeg.
Okay. All right. Does anyone have any other questions? Mayor Hart? No? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Peter Kotick?
Sorry.
Kotick. Peter Kotick, come forward, please. And this is in relation to report number 7, which is the East St. Paul Thoroughpass.
Thank you.
First of all, I apologize for my dress. I was in the garden, and then I got a call from my neighbor that they're going to be talking about Gateway and Raleigh. And,
come on down. Okay.
My name is Peter Kotick. I've lived in North Glenn for in excess of 50 years. I was a little kid there on Bonner when there was only two houses between Gateway and 59. Mm-hmm. And I'm dead set against, with all due respect, to East St. Paul. It's nice for East St. Paul, but I'm telling, I'd like to ask her if she could, but I guess they don't answer questions. What do we get out of it? Other than more traffic, I also happen to be a school trustee, by the way, hi Cindy. I'm a school trustee with Riverview Transcona School Division, the largest school division. We have a number of children that actually have to cross Gateway and Raleigh to get to school, and I'm talking about Donwood, Maple Leaf School, and Emerson. And I've heard that number, by the way, 30,000 vehicles, because there's, at the moment, I think the city's dealing with two traffic problems where there's overpasses over trains, and they're claiming the same number, 30,000 vehicles. This would be potentially 30, and if you're, you, Madam Chair, you mentioned 11,000 people live in Birds Hill. Who's to say they don't take two or three or four trips in a day? I know I'm sometimes in my car going different directions. The other thing, of course, that has been remiss is that the safety of the children, and if they have to cross, are we going to have stoplights or are we going to have traffic lights? And I would talk from Knowles, never mind Glenway, Knowles, Bonner, McIver. I mean, we could have virtually, well, as we do now, six or seven stop signs. And if we're going to try to do traffic circles, which I think the city's contemplating at Sun Valley, to speed up traffic, what are we going to do for the other five or six or seven intersections that right now have stop signs? And if it's going to be traffic, and again, people are going to migrate to where it's the easiest way to get home and the fastest. So again, I ask, what is it? What do we benefit from it? Nothing. I know that during the public province meeting, they were talking that it's a two-way street. I said, I can't remember the last time I went to Birds Hill to buy a car. I can't remember the last time I went to Birds Hill, and I'm using Birds Hill facetiously, East St. Paul, to buy a suit. It's all this way. By that I mean from the north coming south, and then reverse the other way around. They also don't, they have never mentioned the Gateway Community Club, one of the largest community clubs in the city. It's on the corner of Bonner and Gateway. They have these carnivals, winter and summer. Lots of kids, people actually even park on the where the old railway track used to be. That's how busy it is. Right now, it was also mentioned Gateway and Raleigh. If you look at Raleigh at the moment, after you get past McIver, it turns off into Gilmore. Why? Because we all know that the trail that they're talking about has got a bridge that was, by the way, an excellent bridge, over the Chepagus overpass. If Raleigh was to go, it would be virtually right side by each of the overpass, there would be no turning lane. Because it's roughly 50 feet or maybe 65, 70 feet between Raleigh and Gateway. So that's totally not even usable. The only thing they would be able to do is make Raleigh, pardon me, Gateway into a four-lane highway. And who the heck wants that? Like, I still don't understand what we get out of it. I mean, if we have any friends in Birds Hill, we'll visit them. But just like I want to tell you about the school division, we have many people come to our school division asking us to consider busing their children. And I'll tell you why. Because they say there are no sidewalks, and look at these deep ditches. And our funding is limited already, as you might know. We're the lowest cost per student in Manitoba, practically. And we ask them, do your children play outside on a Saturday? And they said, of course. Well, aren't you scared about the fact there's no sidewalk and there's the deep ditch? Because they obviously bought these bucolic properties because they want to be peace and quiet. But what are they going to do? They want to put all the traffic in our backyard. Now, I happen to be lucky. I'm a good 1,000 feet, maybe 2,000 feet from Gateway. But nonetheless, it's my area, the people that I connect with. And it certainly is not going to be any, it will not certainly be what it used to be. It'll be a lot of traffic, like I said. And God forbid if they ever put a Walmart in there, which I think was the plan, previous administration from the city of East St. Paul. And again, we already have two situations. We have a Tim Hortons with one entrance and one exit. And I'm thinking, you know what? Even a little jackrabbit or bunny rabbit is smart enough to have two entrances, one to get in, one to get out, in case there's a fox or something. But what do? We seem to sort of build something all around, and then we try to wiggle through a road or a walkway or a trail instead of the other way around. I was lucky enough to be in Orlando. I'm looking out my 18th floor building, and you'll sort of see like a roadway cut right through a forest. What are we doing here? We clear the forest, make the road, and then we'll put 2,000 trees. There they keep the same vegetation. We tend to always do things slightly backwards. If they're talking about a light rapid transit, that should have been done when the rail was still there. Why didn't we do that before people move in? But we always seem to always do something slightly backwards. We could say no, and you know what? East St. Paul is still going to be there, because if it doesn't get opened up, just for emergency traffic, so be it. Who asked you? I mean, you don't have to live there. You can either take traffic in North Kelowna or live in East St. Paul and take a little longer to get to work or go come home. So I would ask this committee if they have the, well, I'm not sure if you have the decision-making ability, but if you don't, certainly strongly advise against doing that. Because I don't see any benefit, if you did a benefit analysis, like plus and minus, what are we gaining in Winnipeg, I'm just saying? Everybody's a south of the perimeter. I can't think of too many, if any. But I can certainly see a lot of gain there. So if that's the case, then maybe they should help us pay for the taxes. They should help us pay for the road, because the road will virtually, but one day will be from Chiepagues up to the perimeter and beyond. And at the moment, it's only two lanes. Who's going to pay for the four lane? Certainly, you can imagine, first of all, we get the traffic, and then we have the audacity to have to pay for the road? How is that even remotely fair, other than saying, thank you, City of Winnipeg, taxpayers, for paying for the road that we are going to use? So I honestly don't see it. I would recommend this committee or any committee come down and walk Gateway. Come down at 4 o'clock and see what the traffic's like. Come down and talk to the schools. And that's another thing, by the way, schools. You know, we reduce the speed. I've been on the board for 20 years. I don't recall them ever coming to us asking about reducing the speed, but that's another
item. We're talking about this report.
No, I don't. I'm just saying.
Okay.
Anyway, I will end with the fact is that this is a tough decision, obviously. I am for development, by the way, but I'm also for value. And if we built an overpass over the Pegasus Trail, we can certainly do an overpass, because I think, I could be wrong, I think it's a lot cheaper to build an overpass for a bicycle and a corridor, walkway, than it is to put an underpass for a four-lane, perhaps even six-lane, under that. Because that's what the perimeter's going to be. It'll be six lanes, three each way, practically, under the supposedly level crossing. So if the bicycle path and the other path is at level crossing, the rest has to be all dug out. There has to be one humongous hole there to get the traffic underneath, including the semi-trailers and everything.
So were you able to go to any of the open houses?
I did. I spoke to all of them. But again, I happen to be a school trustee. I'm not necessarily talking on behalf of the board. Last year I was the board chair. I am school trustee. And I'm always concerned with education, and I'm always concerned with safety. So when they're talking safety, that is paramount. And when there's that much traffic going there, come winter, slippery conditions, our buses have to travel down. We have 50-foot buses, have to negotiate turns. I can see it being a dog's breakfast. At the moment, it's tough enough as it is. So imagine even if you put 10,000 cars additional, 15, 20, I don't know, whatever it is. But without that study, and just to say that the government's given us $3 million for this little overpass, we're going to take advantage of it. Have they ever been wrong before? I say they have. Many people have. And it's the smart one that says, let's take a look at this, and is this, in fact, the best thing we want? Because if that's the case, why don't we, John Pritchard, Farm Road, why don't we make that into four-lane? That would certainly speed up traffic if you live there. But who would vote for that? Nobody. They say, just a second. I live on Pritchard Farm Road. Why would I want a big highway? But we could certainly make a big overpass over the Large Moya and say, there you go. But the province wants to actually shut down John Pritchard Farm Road. Why? To push more traffic onto Gateway. So I ask, what did we do to the city or the province to deserve that kind of attention, negative attention? I think I've spoken enough. Thank you. By the way, I had to run out because I had to put money in my machine. I thought it would be sooner, but I apologize.
Thank you very much. Do any committee members have any questions?
Thank you for your time.
Okay, so just to clarify, I've been involved. I understand the cycling component of this. Part of the reason of building an separated crossway over on the perimeter highway
which is what occurred on 59 Highway, right? There's the cycling pedestrian overpass. There's a lot of movement of big vehicles and houses and things around the perimeter at certain times. And that wouldn't, with an overpass, it would be extremely long. You'd start far at one end, and you'd have to go very high and far to the other end. So that's not going to work. So what they're doing is they're not digging any tunnel. It's at grade. It's the road at grade. They're not going down at all. It's at grade. And they're just increasing the height of the perimeter.
Now, I'm just saying reverse. Keep the road that it is level grade right now, and that's where the most of the traffic is. Yeah. All you want to do is move, i.e. traffic, walkers, bicyclists, and those people. And it would be much easier to put a small, because especially if you're only talking two lane or one lane or virtually no lane. We're talking, then at least the roads have been already pounded down to Kalska Home. I'm talking about the perimeter highway. Those lanes can go straight east, right around the corner. They don't have to do anything. All we have to do is put a similar, if you will, an overpass like we do at the Chief Pegasus Trail, where at the corner of Gateway and Chief Pegasus, if you will, there's a small pedestrian corridor where you can take a bike, you can walk, you can take a granny, you can take kids, you can go to school. Or even at worst, the one at Raleigh, pardon, Rothesay. Rothesay was built, the underpass went under. Well, the biggest cost was the underpass, because the other part was relatively small. It doesn't take that many big trucks. So if you want to do the best cost effective, it's better to build for two lanes than to have to move six or eight lanes.
So for the purposes of the report here today then, what we're talking about at the report, for the report is, the province is, the city is saying they do not support a combination of general traffic entering the city of Winnipeg, that they do support the controlled for emergency services. So that's the report in front of us. We're not building a road.
I realize I have another tangent, and I agree with that. The only problem is...
You derailed me too.
Yeah,
so.
The only problem, I apologize, is once you get your toe in the door, provincial sales tax, 5%, before you know it, nobody have ever actually taken off. So once you have a road there...
Maybe that's something you need to take up with the province then.
No, but you guys are conditional decision makers too, and you have a lot of influence, and certainly maybe not as much as school boards. But nonetheless, the city has got a lot of influence too, because we would be asked to pick up a significant cost, and that has to work too. Simply to say, we're washing our hands and letting Mr. Salinger and his crew decide our division, our vision of our city is wrong. Because they will also have to pay for either support the light transit or the public transit or any of those costs. And that's also part of decision making. So don't shirk your responsibility. Even though you might think you're city councilors, you guys are awesome. And you can make tough decisions too. Don't just let the MLAs and MPs decide this decision. And certainly myself as a school board member, the bottom of the rung of the ladder, of the political ladder, we also should be here too, and we are. So we have a decision to be made.
I hear you. All right, thank you very much.
Have a great day.
Thank you.
I suggest that you should have been outside because it's
back gorgeous.
Back
to the garden, I know.
Thanks.
All right, good day. Okay. Oh, and now we have Councillor Wyatt, report number 20.
Yeah, thank you. I won't take much of your time, committee. I just wanted to come before you because reports are on your agenda, or motions on your agenda related to 20. So items 6, 8, and 9, in light of 20, my suggestion would be for your committee to receive it as information, report 6, 8, and 9. They were motions that came out of East Kelowna Transcona Community Committee last month without us having the knowledge that this report was arriving here today, which addresses, by and large, the issues identified in those motions. So I just wanted to come for clarification so there was no confusion as you move forward on your meeting. And I would like to thank the committee and the chair and members of EPC for your support for addressing these outstanding issues and projects. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. So we're done our we're done our presentations here.
Yeah, I have no more.
No more? Okay. All right. We'll now move into reports. So we'll start with item number one, the 2014 Comprehensive Integrated Waste Management Strategy Annual Report. It's getting a bit of traction here. Okay.
Please stand up.
All right.
Hello.
afternoon. Maybe introduce yourself to the committee, please, Tim.
I'm Tim Shanks. I'm manager of Water Services Division of Water Risk, but today I'm acting as director of those. And helping me here for this report is Randy Barton, the Solid Waste Division, and we're here with the Finance Administration. So, this first report is the annual report on our comprehensive integrated waste management strategy. Basically, this report is a requirement for an annual update on our progress in this plan. The report highlights the different areas of the plan and where we're at. There's some stats in here. Randy, if you want to highlight, maybe.
Sure, just to go over some of the highlights. Good news, our diversion rate, waste diversion rate is over 29%, and that actually surpasses our target of 25% for 2014.
Can I interrupt here and ask what the question is for the next, say, 10 years? What the goal
is? Our goal is to reach 50%.
It's to reach 50%. So we don't have a 0%. We're aiming for 50%?
Yes. That's as far as what was identified in the comprehensive report and also the Garbage and Recycling Master Plan. So we have short-term projections and long-term projections, but our goal, our ultimate goal, is to go out for 50%. A good portion of that diversion was the fact that we collected almost 30,000 metric tons of yard waste, and that actually is about 3.5 times more and higher than what we actually did in 2011 prior to this Garbage and Recycling Master Plan. Our landfill gas system is performing as expected. We've flared over 4,200 metric tons of landfill gas, which really converts to about 109,000 metric tons of CO2, which is equivalent to avoiding emissions from about 23,000 passenger cars a year. There's actually a 60% reduction in the abandoned waste reports to 311, which is a good thing, and we also have about a 47% reduction in miscollection calls to 311. So that's showing that, you know, not only I believe our service is improving, but also residents are catching on to the new system regarding carts collection for garbage and recycling. I guess the other thing we can look at too is there is a, you know, although there's a nominal increase in garbage, I think the important point is that, and that's collected and landfilled, it's still 16% below 2011 before we actually implemented the program. So that's a good thing.
So Randy, I see a lot of successes here, good news. What are the challenges?
I think the challenges are to continue to get the higher diversion rates. What we did see in 2014 is that our recycling numbers, or our recycling tonnage, actually only increased by a couple percentage points. It's always difficult. We always have to keep communicating the goals and getting the residents to recycle more. So that's one of the challenges.
Will we be measuring the rate of the recovery centers when they come online?
That's gonna assist us. Yes, in 2015 we're looking at opening up the 4R depots, so that's certainly gonna increase diversion, and that's gonna help this rate. Yes, so we're looking forward to that. We're also looking at and we're in the process of doing organics management strategy. So that what that's going to do is it's actually going to look at options to deal with the organics that are collected in the city, and that's not only from single family homes, but that's also multifamilies and commercial establishments. So we know from other jurisdictions that you need that organics diversion component, those programs that support organics diversion, to actually drive up the diversion rates.
So what are we doing about, and I'm new, I'm not read up on other reports, I'm wondering, with the construction industry, you know, with the construction, renovation, and demolition world, there's a lot of waste that comes out of that world.
am I not seeing it in the report here? Or are we addressing it? Or are we looking at that at all? My understanding is that's a big component of garbage in the whole cycle.
It is. The 2011 Garbage and Recycling Master Plan actually identified that, in fact, in sort of the longer term, is in the near term, is to, I guess, begin those discussions with that, you know, with those, with industries, to see how we can drive up diversion from that. I know the longer term is to implement some of those programs. I think with the opening of the 4R, like the 4R Winnipeg depots, where we start now getting even residents involved in segregating their waste, and actually we can actually then translate that and look at some of the you know, the private businesses and some of the construction industry to look at how we can continue that diversion.
Are we talking with industry now on this?
We haven't had any formal discussions yet. No.
Is there plans for that? I guess, you know, I go around the perimeter, I see how South Winnipeg's developing, massive construction, garbage everywhere, going to the landfill. I know in the province, with their strategy, they've recognized it and identified it as a huge priority, or as it, you know, I think it's 30% or something, that it's, that's where the waste comes from. So I'm just wondering, this, with the city, we're not, you know,
well, actually, yeah, not actively at this moment. We did comment on the province's Tomorrow Now document that they put out.
Right,
we did support that, certainly, and we would support going forward and dealing with that industry. We've been really concentrating on the near-term phases and implementing what we're dealing with as far as on the single-family home side, getting the 4R depots in place. And then I think once we, you know, it's the next step in the process.
Mm-hmm. We're also, the next report on the agenda, too, talks about the Waste Diversion Advisory Committee that has a side representation from
From the
so industry. Taking on some input, but it's not exactly true.
Okay, so with the organics program, which we seem to have been talking a lot about lately, we're not 100% sure if we're doing a pilot yet or not. We're studying it to see if we are going to do a pilot. I noticed Brandon, the city of Brandon, is doing an organics collection program. Do you know anything about it at all?
Yes.
It seems to be a volunteer program that people can volunteer into it. If they want to participate, they can. But
a lot of different jurisdictions have different programs,
right.
And I think the most important thing to do is to actually take a look at what are the
study
the, look at Winnipeg itself, look what we need to do, and so that's what the organic strategy is going to do. It's going to not only identify the best option, but then it's going to actually identify issues regarding the implementation plan, which will look at infrastructure, resources, and you know, markets for the end product, and funding mechanisms and how to pay for it. And I think once we get that, then we can certainly take the next step forward and develop a plan that will work for us.
And I guess how are we leading by example at City Hall? I'm new here, you know, I'm looking around, I'm going through papers, and this is a very dismal paper world, it seems. But how are we leading by example in the departments throughout all our departments? What's happening there?
Well, I think what you're leading by example is I noticed there's a glass there instead of a plastic bottle, so that's fantastic.
There you go. Exactly.
But you know what? We have.
Do we have anything like that, or programs, or I mean?
Yes, we have. We have a comprehensive recycling program, and I know that we're looking at it. It's not of our division, but they're also looking at a comprehensive, like a waste management strategy for the corporate city. So I think we're managing okay. I think that you know, just by certainly speaking to the general public, certainly with regards to how the participation in our programs, to see the growth in the tonnage and the that we're collecting since we implemented the plan,
great.
I think it's great.
So yeah.
Like the residents have really responded to it, and I think that's great.
Now, do we have an idea when that the compost study will be done?
Yes, we're looking for a report to come forward early 2016.
The report. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sure this is the format you use to do up your reports regularly. Personally, it would be great to see how we compare to other cities. Okay. I know that's, you know, it's hard to compare apples to apples, but There's probably ways to do it. It would be really great. I have no idea as a city how we're, you know, how we're really relating to other cities. So I don't know if that's, I don't know the process to ask for that to have in the report, but that would be really ideal to see in the report.
Sure. A going forward basis, I mean, I think we can include something like that. And I think as we go, you know, with that in mind now we can actually look at some of these programs, discuss some of the other municipalities that we're comparing to and how they keep track, and so that we can make sure that as much as possible it's apples to apples.
Yeah.
We do, the department does participate in a benchmarking mm-hmm. program with other utilities across the country.
Right.
I'm not sure how much of it, just offhand, how much of it is solid waste wise.
Right.
But certainly in our other, like the rest of the utility is benchmarked against the different performance measures against the utilities.
Right. But this is something that people day to day in their lives, it's impact. So,
but the benchmarking does look at that too.
It does.
So you know, we can use those resources to try and get you something.
Helpful. Sure. You know, it'd be helpful to sort of see it on a bigger scale. For me, it would, but.
There's two benchmarking initiatives that we participate in. There's the OMBI, which is the all of the city, and then there's a National Water, Wastewater, and Solid Waste Benchmarking Initiative as well that we participate in.
And do we have reports that come out on that? I'm sure we must. Or do we see it at all at this table? Or?
The performance measurement of the OMBI, those get, and the other, they get reported as part of the service-based budgets that get tabled with council. So each of the services, there's some mm-hmm. metrics and some measures that are, then that's the source of those that are tabled as part of the budget.
This seems to always to be a report that, I mean, it's the average person can read, and they seem to be able to relate to it from the phone calls and interest I've had over it since it came out. So I don't know if there's some excerpts that could be put into it.
Sure.
Okay. Super. So, any other questions? No? Can I have a motion? I guess we're receiving this as information.
I'll move to receive this information.
Okay. All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Okay. Report number two.
Okay.
Establishment of Waste Diversion Advisory Committee.
Mm-hmm. Yes, this is another report to be received as information. Basically, this is just an update on a recommendation from the Comprehensive Integrated Waste Management Strategy, that the department establishes a Waste Diversion Advisory Committee. It's a committee to provide advice and recommendations to managers of solid waste services on waste and diversion policies.
Tim, just looking at the date here, why has it taken so long to establish this? It was 2011, right, that this was approved by council in October?
It has taken a long time. We've recognized that it really has to do with the resources that we've had and the amount we've traveled since 2011 with respect to the programs that we've implemented. Unfortunately, this didn't get implemented as soon as we had liked, but again, we were more concentrating on the service delivery programs to all the single family homes and the residents.
Establish it today. Tell me what the go forward is going to be like. You're meeting with representatives from these groups that you've outlined here.
Yes.
Yeah. So what we did was we, when we looked at establishing this committee, we wanted people representing certain organizations that would really help us out. And there's a one that we're happy to see is a member of sustainability committee from the Winnipeg School Division Number 1. We've also got Green Manitoba on there. We've got Manitoba Housing. So we've got, I think it's a really good representative of organizations that will be able to help us go forward in the future. We also had a component of residents. And I think what's fantastic about this is that we had over 40 applicants to actually for these five positions, just from general citizens that were really concerned and really wanted to give their input. And we're really, really, really happy with so far some of the input that we've had and the responses that we've got.
Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to point out that this most of this committee, again, they're going to be looking at right off the bat. They'll actually be giving us input on the organics diversion strategy, but other topics can include our four Winnipeg depots, multifamily collection. Certainly, the C&D waste, construction demolition waste, so that they're going to be, we're looking at certainly input from all the variety of people that are sitting on this regarding those things.
So I'm just going to go back to the construction, reno, and demo waste, just because I just see so much of it. So they're not on here. They're not on here. The construction, reno, and, like, I mean, people from the construction industry, they're not on here. It's, that's not sort of the committee that you're going for. I get that. So just going, how will we, how would we get more action on that? What would be the suggestion to see more action on working with the construction industry?
I think that...
What would be required?
Yeah. I think, first of all, we could do is, again, speak to the province, and we could do it as a two-pronged approach and discuss with the province to get in with industry to look at it. I think industry itself, I mean, they have a number of different initiatives that are driving, you know, either it's recycling or just waste diversion. You know, at their sites, basically, especially new construction sites. If you go around, you'll see some, certainly some buildings are built with LEEDS program, which looks at different, whether it's, you know, alternate energy, whether it's energy savings, or whether it's, you know, recycling of debris. It's even garbage disposal and how much recycling that they're doing. So that there are programs in place. I think it's a matter of us, the city, looking at what we're actually receiving at our Brady Road Resource Management Facility. And, you know, that's part of it. But also, I think with the province, you know, we can sort of do it and liaison with them and actually deal with industry to see how we can possibly drive those things up. I think what's important, though, is we just need some infrastructure in place to deal with that. And we're going to be starting off with the residents and dealing their waste. With the 4R depots, we will be able to start separating things
up. You're saying we would need different infrastructure in place to deal with the refuse, with the garbage that's coming from the construction industry?
Well, what we'd have to do is actually look to see how much volume we're receiving and what's out there. That's the first thing to do is what are we dealing with? And then we'd have to look at resources that
we
need to
deal
with.
How do we do that? How do we get...
Part of this is certainly one of the topics that the committee would be engaged in addressing in terms of, you know, trying to identify and source out construction waste. The framework of this committee, you know, has not been fully defined in terms of if you can go where it needs to go. The membership of the committee can change as well. We could end up with having a construction association member out there, that sort of thing. It's just that we want to start the committee, establish a framework, and we can change over time.
Could we look at that? Because, like, really, it's, if I'm correct, I believe it's 30% provincially. That's the amount of waste that we're getting, and we're growing. We're an expanding city. We're wanting to grow to 1 million people. There's so much happening in the South End still, all over the South End, your end of town.
We could. I guess, you know, we have to remember that our mandate is basically residential waste. That's what we can control. A lot of the private commercial businesses, you know, they're basically responsible for the waste that they generate. We're looking at our near-term phase of the CWIMP document and the master plan is to look at, again, address residential waste.
So whose mandate is it to look at the industry?
Well, industry governs itself. I mean, you know, you've got corporations that have mandates and that choose to be environmentally green. So they make sure they put in programs. But for the most part, it's we're looking at the residential stream.
Randy, I may have missed it in the conversation here about the recovery centers. Will they allow for this construction waste?
Certainly residential. Yes,
residential.
Absolutely.
Yeah, not massive volume. Right?
Well, there's a bit out there from residents, though.
Oh, yeah,
I think the key thing is that then get everyone thinking to separate that waste so we can deal with it.
Okay.
I'll move to receive this information.
Oh, super. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Item number 3, closure of hauled wastewater disposal facility at the South End Sewage Treatment Plant.
Yes, this is another report tabled as information to apprise the Standing Committee that we're discontinuing planning to discontinue the reception of hauled waste at the South End plant. And so the report details it, but basically The, right now at the South End Sewage Treatment Plant, we receive hauled waste from various bulk haulers. And the nature of this waste is such that sometimes it can be very concentrated. And it carries a risk of upsetting the processes that we're building at the South End Plant. And so to protect those processes, we're going to close this truck dump facility and redirect all this type of traffic to our facility, our existing facility with some upgrades at the North End Plant. The North End Plant is better suited to handle this type of waste, both because of the processes there and also because of the volume of waste that it takes. The North End Plant is our largest plant. This follows, I believe we closed the West End disposal facility a few years ago. But so that's basically this report is to inform you of that. We have consulted with the haulers. This isn't we don't directly. The haulers are interfaced between us and the customers. So there will be an increased cost to some haulers depending on where they're coming from, mm-hmm. and that cost will be passed on to the customers. But basically, this decision is being made to protect the process of the plant.
And you had that meeting was in January.
Yes, mm-hmm. It was the most recent meeting.
And how do they receive this information? I mean, it is an added cost to whoever they're hauling for. I guess that's what it's passed down to.
Yeah. We do have a breakdown of how many haulers use that point and the expected impact between them. But we certainly communicate with them. Yeah, the cost. The feedback we got is the cost is going to be passed on to customers.
Okay. Yeah, great. All right. Can I have a motion to receive this as information, please?
I'll concur with the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service.
Okay, great. Super. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Item number 4, agreements for supply of collection and handling service to producer responsibility organizations.
So this report is to look for approval to enter into these agreements with these producer responsibility organizations and to delegate authority to the CEO to negotiate and approve some of the agreements. What this is about is, I should just let Randy talk about this really. This is another solid waste item here.
Yeah, sure. So the producer responsibility organizations, or the PROs as we refer them to, they're recognized by the province of Manitoba as the official stewards of their respective materials. So when we look to partner and to recycle these types of waste, we basically are directed to deal with these organizations. Looking at the component of the 4R depots is all about diversion, but a component of it is an actual to deal with some of the hazardous materials and deal with their disposal. So it's kind of like a one-stop shop. So what we're looking to do is we're looking to provide that service to the residents. They can come in, drop off these hazardous materials, and we'll collect them, but then we need the agreements with these pros so that they would actually come in and then take them off our hands, so take them and actually properly dispose of them or properly recycle them. So what these agreements do is it not only ties down operational details, but it does tie down some of the financial compensation that we receive for handling their materials.
So, in essence, it's not a rebate, but we will be getting funding back, as my understanding is, at the 4R depots from some of these.
Yes. Yeah. So the ones that are identified here, we're showing that they have a positive 10-year net present value to the city. So basically, it allow us to collect electronic products, allow us to collect, tires and all the rest of that. And then we will, again, receive compensation from these organizations for the services of collecting them.
So when we spoke about the depots a couple meetings ago, we talked about paint also. And that this is going to be a facility that will hold these materials, including paints?
Yes, it's going to be a structure that's going to hold and look after some of these. Of course, if you have small consumer batteries, you don't need a big facility, but certainly electronics and in used oil and some of the other products, you know, that they're going to, some of the large, the products that have the larger materials, larger quantity of materials, and, you know, the a little bit more detailed handling procedure would need to be inside. I have to point out that actually the paints are not included in this group. We're still negotiating with Product Care Association that deals with the paints, and we'll come to the committee with a report on that shortly.
Okay, so this is, does anyone have any questions or concerns, or it's just sort of moving forward on the process? So can I have a motion to move it?
I'll move to the city.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. All right. Perfect. Item number 5.
So item number 5 is the admin report for single source negotiations and award of the contract for Manitoba Hydro Works associated with the Copeland Calrossi land drainage improvements. So the reason for the report is we need council approval to sole source anything over $1 million, and this is anticipated to be about $4 million. That's the estimate Hydro has provided. So basically what this is the part of the Parker Ponds that that we're preparing to construct requires the relocation of some Manitoba Hydro power lines. And Manitoba Hydro is the statutory required, they're the only people that that are allowed to work on their own lines. And so we have to sole source the work to them to relocate this. And they provide us with that estimate, and basically the report includes some information on the background, on the history about it, but the nature of the report is to ask for permission to start those sole source negotiations. Other than that, there's a map included in the report to kind of highlight the area we're talking about. You know, we have some additional information brought to the meeting, just pictures of the, there was a question of the picture of the
couple towers. Yeah,
like the existing towers and what the new ones would look like, and if that helps.
This
is
what we have.
Sure.
Yep.
And something like that.
These are the new ones, right. Yeah. Just drove to Minneapolis and saw the massive on the side of the road there. Okay. Questions?
I know that one of the presentations that was brought up that about the environmental license. Do we have the proper licenses in place?
Well, what I know right now is that there's a reference to the Parker Ponds in the environmental license for the Bus Rapid Transit project. Which states that any wetlands have to be any wetlands that are removed because of construction have to be replaced in the proposed Parker Pond development. So while this pond will take some runoff from the BRT project, it's for the basement flooding relief project primarily, right? So. That's the license reference that I have right now. There shouldn't be any. We can follow up on any license requirements for construction.
Generally,
for hydro.
No, generally, an environmental license for a pond is not required when we're building. We're basically building a hole in our own land, so generally, it's not required. Our developers who build ponds, whatever, there's no environmental license required.
Environmental license is required because of the transit corridor.
Yes, because of BRT. So there's a reference there.
Can you just get back to us and confirm it?
We can confirm that.
Yeah.
I have one question. Were some of these lines being moved already?
No, not these lines. There's lines that are being moved as a part of the BRT project.
They're a little bit further down, I guess?
They are west and south of this project.
Okay. Wanted to confirm that.
And
Do you want to just talk about the, we had a delegation that was concerned about the $70.1 million and the capital budget combined sewer and overflow account?
Yeah, well, we have, it's an overall budget that's right now is at $70 million. And funds from that program are dedicated to various basement flood relief programs. We have Ferry Road basement flood relief program that's going on, the Jefferson storm relief program that's going on, the Colby Tallahassee storm relief program that's going on. We have projected into the up to the 2020 budget, our calendar year, in the order of $165 million that will go to. And we just continue to draw from that account to do the works we have to do.
So do you know how that account is reported on to finance? Like, is it part of, I mean, with Pratt and Moira, you're here, you might be able to answer that better, right? Sorry. Like, you know, with anything over $10 million, we report. Yeah.
If anything's over $10 million in the budget.
Like, so if any particular item coming out of this $70
million. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's just the $70 million is a fund, as a fund for an ongoing program with many projects within it. It's the same as our, it's not really any different than our water main renewal reserve, which gets funded, and then different projects. So it's really the decision point for a major capital project reporting is the amount of the capital budget. So this one is below the $10
million. Okay. We'll have a one of the projects that we're looking at probably starting 2 or 3 years down the road in the Ferry Road area is about a $20 million project. That project will go through a formal. Yep. Yeah, that's a huge project.
That's and the one that we're overflowing in a few years back.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So how confident are you on the hydro estimate? Because we had a little episode here a while back, and the estimate was way off. Well, and I know it's out of our control.
I asked that question when my dealings with hydro, and I said, can you guarantee this number? Can you provide us with some assurance that this is the number we're going to live with? He said, no, we can't. We will not do that. But we believe this is a conservative estimate with a lot of contingency in the budget, and you'll get what you get, and it may eventually today cost you less. If all goes well, it'll be less. So
will we hear back at this committee what it ends up costing? It'll come to finance, right? It
will
come
to we'll committee. Be issuing a contract, I guess, at the end of the day, after the work is all done, certainly. I mean, what happens is this becomes a time and material contract. Basically, they just build it, and whatever hours takes them to build it, whatever it costs, they just send the bill to us.
Yeah. And does it come back here? Do we end up seeing it here, or does it go to finance?
Not that I'm aware of.
I'd really like to. I'm just curious.
It wouldn't
see.
Actually go to either. It wouldn't go to finance because it's below the $10 million threshold.
Right, yeah.
So it wouldn't
it would
part of the major capital reporting cycle.
I mean, I guess there's nothing we can do about it.
If we come back to ask for more money, we'll be here.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Okay, I don't want to see you on this one then. Okay. 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 All right. Any other questions of administration, counselors? Nope. All right. Okay. Would someone like to make a motion, please?
I forget where I was going to do that.
Thank you.
I'll move that we concur in the recommendation.
Okay. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Right. All right. So report number 6.
This is one of the ones Wyatt mentioned.
Yes.
Receive so this we'll is information.
Okay.
Chair.
All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Report number 7. All right. Mr. Satcher. Great. Okay. Good afternoon. Okay, so we've heard from delegations on this this item here. So, would you like to enlighten us with administration's perspective and reasonings and thoughts on why these recommendations are being made?
Sure. The recommendations that are being made. The first recommendation is essentially in keeping with what was expected through all of the discussions, and in fact, for the most part, particularly with the AT component of it, would be consistent with what was identified in the Transportation Master Plan. We had always envisioned connectivity
beyond the barrier that PTH 1 could be in is to active transportation, that there would be some sort of a crossing, not unlike what is over Chippewas Trail or what you see at Birdsill Park over 59. So the report essentially talks about our support for that part of it, with the supplement that if it could be a controlled emergency access, we would not have a serious concern with that, but it would have to be appropriately controlled so that we don't have general traffic going through. The reason why we don't want general traffic going through is because the road network is not intended south of the perimeter. It's not intended to take large volumes, and I understand that, you know, the consultant may be at this point saying, you know, it might be 3,000 vehicles a day at opening, but those 3,000 vehicles a day, even at opening, have to come down into those neighborhoods and disperse somewhere. Rather than staying on the expressway and arterial network that is Henderson Highway, Lagimodier, and PTH 101. That's what they're intended for. There's a highway or a network hierarchy of streets that any city, any jurisdiction has. And they're there for a reason. They collect the traffic when you leave a local area on a local street, a residential street. You connect to a collector street. From there, you collect to arterials. From there, it keeps going up in a hierarchy of streets. What this is talking about is creating connectivity beyond our boundaries and inviting traffic in that was not anticipated when the street system was established in its current form. So it means more traffic on Headmaster, for instance, which is a collector street, obviously connecting with Lagimodier. It means more traffic into the area. If you were to build it now to accommodate general traffic, it's not just a matter of where it's going to be in a few years at opening. We have to try and predict, and it is an educated guess when you're predicting 20 or 30 years out what the traffic volumes might be, because there's a lot of unpredictability about that. But in general, we know it's going to be more than 3,000 vehicles a day. That's just what happens. We know that there would be, and we heard a little bit of it today, a significant degree of concern in the neighborhoods that would then have to have traffic from another jurisdiction coming in and utilizing the road network. And at this time, and we say in the report, at this time, we're not recommending that council support the notion of a through pass that would accommodate general traffic.
But no one's asking for that, right? Like, no one's asking for a through pass. The province wants to build a road, and they want to have it regulated for emergencies. They're not asking for a open all the time.
Today, mayor jurisdiction.
No, she's wanting it regulated. She's fine with regulating.
What I heard is
today.
build the accommodation in now for future, which means you're building it to take general traffic. And what we're saying is not a good idea for Winnipeg.
So continue on and I'll have questions.
So, Brad, it's not a good idea right now, or?
Ever.
A lot of things can happen, obviously. As Winnipeg grows, as the capital region grows, what is now Perimeter Highway may in fact become an interior highway of a bigger capital region. You look at all kinds of things. You don't look at individual punching of holes, you know, here and there. All kinds of things could happen in the future, many, many years down the road. There may be other reasons for that connectivity, that
can happen from all kinds of development and changes in boundaries, all kinds of things. Lots of examples of that all around North America, where cities grow, and they grow beyond the sort of the current limits, and what used to be way out in the countryside is now in a heavily developed area as a major roadway.
So if we approve this report as is, how would we, Mayor Hart had mentioned she'd like to have future conversations and explore the future viability, how would we do that at a later date?
Those conversations can still happen, but you know we were asked to provide a report, which we did here, and specifically the request about construction for general traffic is not something that we're recommending at this time.
So the Capital Region has developed their master transportation plan, or they've developed a transportation master plan. The city has one. How do we work with the regions on our transportation network?
We had a representative of the city on the Capital Region transportation master plan.
On that process, but how do we now that that committee's dissolved, how do we now continue working with the province on the development of the Capital Region, and how do we work with the surrounding municipalities? Like, how do we work with, you know, so many people live out there and come in and out, how do we work with these municipalities, all the mayors and
things? Obviously the civic portion of provincial government, no different than the public service here in the city of Winnipeg, follow the direction of our respective elected officials. In the course of doing that, we on a regular basis talk back and forth with our counterparts of the province. Louis spends a lot of time talking to his counterparts about all kinds of things, everything from traffic issues to construction issues, things that come up related to transit. There's always a desire to have transit service. That comes up into the realm of the transit department that Dave Wardrop and his folks have. So these discussions are happening all the time. Being consistent, though, with our direction from our elected officials and the policies that have been set forward. So that becomes our roadmap for what we do.
So I think the mayor had a really good point in that I understand number two, but I don't know, I think a softening of the words in working collaboratively with the municipality and looking, definitely at this point in time, we're all in agreement that this will be an emergency access road only, but to work collaboratively as the Capital Region grows and as the city grows, to work collaboratively on this and to look at the Capital Region Transportation Plan in conjunction with the City of Winnipeg Transportation Plan.
And at some point in the future...
And maybe it's just words, but...
Well, the subtle difference there, though, is that that would be prefaced on us saying, yes, we think this is a good idea. We don't think it's a good idea.
At this point in time,
absolutely.
But like you say, things can change, and I mean, we have to be planning. I mean, at this point in time, right now, it's not. But who's to say that down the road it wouldn't be a good idea?
Absolutely, the wording does not preclude that from happening if something were to change that would change the environment.
Right.
What we know right now,
right.
If everything played out the way we know it right now. Jurisdictions stay the way they are, growth is the way it is.
This is a snapshot in time, but if we cannot work
towards...
Then we
don't recommend it.
Yeah.
And Bob, this is one report in front of us, that larger planning, are we doing that? Those are other conversations. If you want it tied to this, the words, right? Are we having those conversations? They exist, right?
The one thing that I'd like to mention is that the city is a member of the what is called the Partnership of the Manitoba Capital
Region.
We have our city planner,
we put a lot of money into that.
And a discussion in that group, in that partnership, is development and a lot of collaboration in many different areas. Transportation is one of them where that happens. And the chief planner and myself are members of the Capital Region Transportation Master Plan Working Group. So we are always in discussions with jurisdictions around the city of Winnipeg and the province when it comes to transportation-related matters and land development.
Mm-hmm. So those conversations are happening.
Leave the chair of this committee as well.
Okay, I do have a concern with doing an underpass or tunnel or whatever you have it, because I don't think it's convenient for Winnipeg. It's done necessarily just for East St. Paul. We don't need the tunnel. I mean, it's great for active transportation, but the minute you build a tunnel and you make it big enough for traffic to go through,
it's there already. Traffic crosses there already. There's already an emergency sort of gate thing there already. Like, it's already there.
So yes, but you can make it a lot more convenient.
Madam Chair, too, I just want to, there was a lot of talk that, I just want to remind, if anyone drives out on a Friday at night on Highway 59, they will see that there's a large exodus of Winnipeggers going out that way, too. So they could be using those. You know, if there's an accident on the highway, that could easily be a Winnipeg person as well. So just, I know that right now what's in front of us is just that the public service be authorized to plan for accommodation of cyclists, pedestrian, and required emergency vehicles. That's what's in front of us. Yeah. And yeah. And I would like to move that, what's in front of us.
Is that a motion on that floor, people?
Yes.
Okay, that's a motion on the table.
Yeah.
All right, would you like to consider putting some wording into point two, working more collaboratively on it, and working the wording into it?
I understand, but for me, it's wording. I'm willing to work collaboratively. You know, I just think that we're talking about a wording, mm-hmm. and I think that, you know, we are going to be working collaboratively with our partners, and I definitely want to make sure that our partners here know that, and they can call me. And I'm sure they can call any member of council, but I mean, right now we're just talking about a wording. We do work collaboratively at the City of Winnipeg, and we have to make sure that we're not just, you know, getting caught up sometimes on a wording because it's more polite. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Contrary? Carried. Item number 8. Grassy Boulevard. Oh no, wait. That was yes. That's one of
Councillor. Yeah, that was information.
Okay,
Councillor Dobson.
All in favor? Contrary? Right. Carried.
Number 9 is the same.
9. All in favor? Contrary? Carried.
Okay. I'd like to refer number 10 to the administration. Is 90 days okay with you, or do you need more?
That wouldn't be enough.
You need more.
Whatever the September meeting.
The September 8th meeting? Yeah, so we'll just amend the 90 days to the September 8th meeting. Councillor Sharma, that was your motion?
Yes.
All in favor? Contrary? Item number 11. Now, we did receive communication from a gentleman on this one. All right. Yeah. Oh, here it is right here. Okay. So, would the committee like an explanation from administration on it? It's a really busy road.
When are you doing the land use study? Is that coming up in the future?
We're in the process of developing the terms of reference for the mm-hmm. for this what we're calling the Eastern Rapid Transit Corridor study, mm-hmm. and it'll review all of the land use of the Point Douglas. That land use, as well as figuring out where the best location will be for the rapid transit corridor to cross the Red River. Mm-hmm. And what we are saying in this report is that it will be advantageous to mm-hmm. include that as part of the.
So you're leaving it till that time, yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to move the recommendations of the public service, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Yeah. Aye.
Contrary? Aye. Carried.
There was the second recommendation actually also indicated that the existing crosswalk, painted crosswalk, should be removed. And I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
That's what you're recommending, right?
Yeah. You saw that.
Okay.
Got a letter from someone about that, too.
Item number 12, amendment to the City of Winnipeg Streets and Traffic Bylaws, Central Park Canada Way, area roads.
Yeah, it's essentially procedural.
Mm-hmm. You're just renaming some roads?
Well, it's designations, but it's as a result of the creation of Central Park Canada Way, and how Sturgeon ties into it for truck access.
Mm-hmm. So it's a bylaw amendment?
Perfect, yeah. It's amending the various bylaws.
I'd like to move the recommendation, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Item number 13, traffic improvements, Ness Avenue and Mount Royal Road.
So you got the MPI data you were waiting for?
Yeah.
Okay. And you're requesting an extension of time? So, yeah. Any questions on this?
September?
I believe they put the date right in there, Council. Is that correct? November 24th?
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. All in favor? Oh, sorry. Motion?
To Council Charlotte's
motion.
Okay. All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Item number 14.
Greg Road. Speed limit. So we're recommending that the speed limit on Prairie Grove Road itself between St. Anne's and Lacombe not changed at this time. I think there was some confusion perhaps in the area on what was actually designated as higher speed and the rules around, unless otherwise posted, 50 mm-hmm. and 90 apply. And so all roads other than this section of Prairie Grove in that area mm-hmm. are 50. Mm-hmm. So this is just the one road. Is that correct?
I believe the councillor for the area was quite involved in this one. Is he aware? Yeah, I think he was, yeah. Move that recommendation, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. All right. Item number 15, pedestrian corridor at Chief Pegwas School on Rothesay.
Just wondering about the financial implications. Where does this money come from if we approve it today?
The money is
already in the budget?
Included in traffic engineering improvements.
Under a general line item, you have money for this item. Yes.
So our recommendation is that a crosswalk,
mm-hmm. not a corridor, but a crosswalk, be constructed.
Mm-hmm. And what is the difference, quickly, Brad, on that again?
The corridor is what the committee requested was the one with the flashing beacons. Yes. Yeah, because of the nature of the road, the amount of traffic, and the amount of pedestrian activity that we see in the for this particular crossing location, we analyze that information based on the Canadian guidelines for traffic control devices for pedestrians, which is the one adopted by the City of Winnipeg, mm-hmm. and that leads us to the proper traffic control device, which is a pedestrian crosswalk, right. Sign and white crosswalk.
So that'll be the sign and the lines?
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're building proper ramps and everything.
I looked at it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This is good news.
I'll move that, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Item number 16.
This is for the access to the proposed residence.
Oh, yeah.
The development at 70 Hugo, and we're recommending that the bylaw be very, in other words, we're good with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
BRT is right behind you. That's right. Okay. Remember that one.
I'll move it, Madam Chair.
Okay. All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Item number 17. Mm-hmm. Capital local street renewals, alley renewals, BTO, TBO, granular roadway improvements. Okay. So pretty self-explanatory.
Mm-hmm. Should have had more on my street.
Well, you know what, maybe what we can do is have the administration explain to us how these, you know, high-level on the process.
I'm just kidding.
Just also to...
Or not, but...
Okay.
Go ahead.
Sorry. Here, so I guess, Councillor...
I know that one of the presenters talked about the bike transit routes.
Yes.
And I was wondering if, like, is there consideration? Like, how do we deal with those? I mean, I know that some are coming up in my ward, and I want to make sure that are we prepared and we can do those things. And
we always are. Well, obviously, opinion on what should or shouldn't be done varies. And we have the greatest respect for Mr. Swanson. His passion for active transportation is almost unparalleled. What happens is our process for designing streets goes through our consultants, or sometimes we do some internally. Those drawings are circulated through our transportation division, where active transportation is housed, and we look for those opportunities. I guess that opinions may vary on what should be done, what could be done, you know, that something may or may not be missed, but we look for those opportunities. And particularly when we're expending capital dollars as part of the program, and in particular, when an active transportation route is identified along the street, we are required to find a way to integrate active transportation into that route. It helps with not only that particular street, but the continuity of other routes. Some of the things are doable, other things aren't, and so it definitely is taken into account.
So, of these projects, then there's how many roads? Over 150. There's more than 150 projects here. How many of them would have an active transportation component, a walking, biking, transit component?
Yeah, because they're local roads,
which are really critical around schools and stuff, right?
Absolutely. And as you know, we have many programs around schools and doing more all the time. And when it comes to transit, typically transit would be present on our collector network. So while there are local collectors, the projects that tend to be done on the local collector system would typically be the TBO program, the Thin Bituminous Overlay program. And we look for opportunities. Quite often the access to the transit stops are improved. We work very closely with transit in terms of what they may or may not need. And even things like accommodating new bus shelters, those kinds of things. In the neighborhoods, you would typically not find, you know, the types of displays that you see in the higher density downtown. From a transit perspective, but certainly accommodating transit. And as you know, sidewalks on local streets we see as part of an active transportation network. They accommodate various forms, in particular walking. And, you know, for instance, last year we know that we did about 12,000 meters, so 12 kilometers, of sidewalk work. The vast majority of that, a sidewalk that might be on average a meter and a half wide, 12 kilometers of that, the number adds up. We did about 15,000 square meters of renewal of an existing sidewalk and about 3,600 square meters of new installations. So, a significant amount of work happens on the sidewalks, and that's where some of the opportunities for accessibility come in. What we construct by policy is to be consistent with the accessibility bylaw that we have and the different policies. will install, when appropriate, will install those tactile embedments that you see on the approaches to sidewalks, so people who are visually impaired know when they're entering or exiting the sidewalk area.
So of this 60 million here, of this, you know, 59 million, how much, I mean, I guess you don't have that now. You have no idea how much is pedestrian, cycling.
Yeah, we don't currently break things down in that way. That would be a change in how we do it.
So I hear you that it would be a change. And we talked about this before, and I drafted up a motion that I would like to make, and that I would like to, if we have to massage it a bit more, but $60 million is a lot of money that's going to local roads. There's a lot of lost opportunities that have occurred over the years in the past. I truly believe, and I think that you would be in agreement with me, that there's been lost opportunities in the past before. We're really moving forward to being more open and transparent here at City Hall. We're looking at creating roads are for more than just cars. They're for walking, they're for cycling, they're for use of transit. I think it would be, you know, and I mean, I'd like to make this motion, and if it doesn't work out, if we have to change it or modify it after we look at it for a bit, or if we try working through it, but I really would like to see, in an open, transparent way, of this $60 million in neighborhoods where, in local streets where schools are in the communities, I'd really like to see, even at a high level, an estimation of what percentage of $60 million would be going towards sidewalks, because we do tender this out. We do, I know the tendering process, it doesn't itemize it down like that, but at a high level, some sort of estimate, some sort of system coming back on transportation projects. So we may have to massage this motion more after we look at it again, but I think it's important that we have a clear understanding of how much is for sidewalks.
Madam Chair, does your motion, that would be for go forward, because I
pardon me?
That would be for go forward.
It would be for go forward, and I'd like to ask if administration could come back.
Because this report in front of us, how many of these local and regional streets have been tendered? I'm sure that process has started.
Oh yeah, that's all. But I mean, they could still look at that. They could still look at the $60 million and come back and say, of the $60 million, we are anticipating, once the tenders all come back, we're anticipating, or we now know, that X amount of this local road improvements has gone towards walking and biking, which roads are more than just for cars.
Mm-hmm. What about our active transportation strategy that's going to be coming?
And that's, I'm told it's going to be coming forward at our next committee. And
so is that something that goes hand in hand with that, perhaps, and we can talk?
Well, I mean, this is separate from that. This is roads, but roads are more than just for cars.
We have in draft pedestrian and cycling strategies out. Work has been going on for a couple of years, and it's moving closer, I believe, to coming forward. What we do annually, though, and bring to this committee for approval is it's entitled our active transportation action plan, and that's an annual plan. Here's the budget for this year.
Mm-hmm. The active transportation budget.
Action. Yeah.
Not the road budget. The active transportation budget.
No, it's part of the active transportation budget, and it explains what we're doing specifically from that budget. And it involves everything from new paths to...
for the active transportation line items. In the
it's part of the active transportation right. program.
Right,
yes,
right.
Which is different than this, and certainly...
Yeah, and that's great. That's
there
fantastic.
Are components of this, mm-hmm. Of these works, that certainly could be categorized with the breakdown of the different transportation modes.
I guess, you know, in the light of transparency and openness, and in the light of, you know, roads are for, as we saw in the presentation, roads are for people and roads are for walking and driving and biking. And maybe it's a way in our transportation reports that we understand what percentage or what allocation of funding, because really it all boils down to the money. It all boils down to funding. What percentage in it, and maybe some will have none, and maybe some will have some. But I think we need to be clear. I know 4 years ago I came to City Hall and I asked that we be clear in our regional roads, that we see the breakdown in our regional roads. And we have that in our regional roads now, correct? How it's the regional roads with the policy, how it's broken down.
In terms of our guidance, including active transportation. In the
yeah. Region. So, and that was, it's really valuable to have a clear understanding of how we're allocating our money. And so we see it ourselves as councillors, so the public sees it, and so, you know, administration and staff see it. And yes, it will be some work to do this, but maybe we will work together to figure out a way that suits everyone's needs, that suits your needs, that suits the public's needs.
In terms of a breakdown, it would be very difficult to do it on a street-by-street basis. We
right.
certainly would have the information that we could extract.
Yeah, but I mean, we're not, and maybe that's what it is.
But reporting it as a, from a global
out of $60 million that we're looking at right now, you know, approximately what percentage is
cycling,
walking, pedestrian. I think that's I think that's important. I think the public would like to see it. We're hearing more and more. We're putting all this effort into the cycling strategies. We've been working on it for years, and it's great that we're doing $60 million in roads. And we know that there'll be a percentage of it. I'm sure there'll be a percentage of it that will be for sidewalks because that's what this is. It's for upgrading in sidewalks, and it's good to see it because when you see it, you understand it, and it just creates more transparency and accountability.
So, I mean, for next year's report, what would happen in the interim is we would provide instruction to our consultants and say, when you are putting your projects together, keep a tally of what's of your quantities, what would fit into those categories, so that when it comes in, it can be compiled.
I know it's more than clicking the buttons, but you know what, in the spreadsheets and all that, I'll put them there and hit the sums.
Like that. Yeah. But
I know that it's more than that, I know that.
No,
but
at the high level, that's what it is.
Right,
it's,
at the high level.
It's,
sure.
It's gathering the information in our age. What we need to do, of course, our age of various electronic tools, is to make sure that going into it, we know what we want as an output. So in this case, if the output that we're desirous of is to have those breakdowns for those four categories, then we, as we go into the projects for next year,
right.
can make a concerted effort to right. ensure that all of our consultants who provide resources, anything we do internally, anything in Louis' group related to this program and these groups of categories is broken out. Yeah, and that's something that we can include in next year's report as
right.
you described it.
So that would be wonderful. Are we, mm-hmm. now is it possible at some point in time in the next few months as your tenders come in and such to just give us a high level on this $60 million?
It wouldn't be because it would be very difficult, very time consuming, and it would be extremely difficult because we didn't set ourselves up for it
right.
going into
right.
it.
So you couldn't give a high level estimation of the $60 million we're putting in roads, what percentage would be, even let's say after the season is done, let's say come once you've built the sidewalks and once you've, like, surely once the projects are done, you'd be able to put someone on that to just summarize at very high level how much went to
yeah.
sidewalks. Like, it would be really valuable to understand.
Yeah, and I understand that. The issue, though, is in this time of the wonderfully increased capital budget, these folks don't get a break in between, and in fact, there's quite a bit of overlap. So as they're, as our consultants included, as they're going through the construction season, they're focusing on the delivery of the programs, building them, making sure they're done right. At the same time, they're starting to work on next year's stuff. So there really isn't a, okay, we're done that, now we've got time to go back and crunch all of this stuff. Because that part of it would be quite manually intensive because we weren't set up in advance to do it. So it's at this point, we're so far along with tendering this year's work that we're just literally not set up to do it. It would be extremely labor intensive, mm-hmm. and I'm not sure that the information we'd be able to provide you would be particularly reliable, simply because we'd be jury-rigging things to try and get an answer, and with the size of even last year and this year's program, particularly, around $60 million, we start to get into numbers that can stop making sense if there isn't something behind it. And we would really have to be guessing at a lot of stuff.
So you won't know, though, how much new sidewalk has been put in once it's put in? Like, I guess I just have a really hard time understanding. In $103 million, you can't come back and say, 2%, 5%, like that's impossible to do? I mean, it's not impossible to do. It just takes so much time, we can't do it?
Here's the issue. I don't know what the percentage is, but it's probably 90 or 95% of our program, capital program, engineering is delivered by consultants. They don't have an integrated system that links all of their individual systems together. Every one of those consultants for every one of these streets, and they're responsible for dozens of streets sometimes, would have to go in and pluck all of that information out for each of these categories, compile it for their group, then it's got to come into us, we've got to compile it. So there's all these moving parts, and it's not integrated for this use.
So from our asset management system, though, I'm getting a complete training on asset management and how that works. Don't we have a record of what new sidewalks, I'm sure we do, have a record of what new sidewalks are in and put in, or pieces are put in, and we can't scoop that somehow?
We have an incredible amount of information, but not
sorry, Cindy, you have a question?
Specifically in
this
that
might,
way.
This might help because my question is kind of related. So, for example, if we're putting a new road in, like, we'll use an older neighborhood like Daniel McIntyre as an example. We're putting a new road in, and we say we're going to designate a side for a bike lane on that road. Would that necessarily come out of the active transportation budget, or was it just be inclusive in the project? Or if we were going to add a light at the end of the street so people could cross with their bikes, would that be a different line item?
Typically not. If we have a capital project, it's typically integrated into the project.
Okay.
And that historically is how it's happened. It's very rare that we would pull money from a separate budget and plunk it in. It happens. But for the most part, those capital projects, in keeping with some of the stuff that Mr. Swanson was talking about earlier, you have a pot of money available to you. And if you go in from a planning perspective early on, you can look for those opportunities and include those things, and we do.
So
much of our signal renewal program is done as part of the street renewal program.
Okay, but so moving forward in the future, when you're doing these projects, you could actually look at that now and take that into consideration moving forward.
Yeah, that's the idea.
Going back is kind of hard to start digging through all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But moving forward, you could.
Because we would tell all of our resources.
Well, because people would know to collect this.
We're going to need this at the end.
Right.
They could set it up to collect that information.
That's basically what we want, right?
Well, yeah, and that's what we want moving forward.
Okay. Moving forward.
Yeah. So I'd like to. That's the motion.
Yes, same.
It's just mind-boggling that we don't have the technology or the ability to even do a high-level estimate.
We have amazing technology, but like anything else, you can have technologies that are fit for a certain purpose, but if they're not integrated specifically to pull that information out.
Yeah, no, I get that. I totally get that.
That's a different line. You can't pull it. Okay, good. Move on.
Not that we can't.
I'm just fine. I get it. I'm not happy with approve. Like, I'm happy to approve $60 million in roads. I'm not happy that we have no high-level estimate ability to say how much is going to walking and biking. But moving forward, we will improve the system, and we will be able to know this next year.
So the directive is just through the conversation?
Yeah, and then, we'll make the motion. I'd like to make the motion so that we can do it for next year.
That would be after the end.
Sure, we can do it.
She can do it now. There's no motion for item 30 on the table.
Has the department seen the motion?
Yep.
Or can we read it?
The mayor's office has seen it.
Okay.
Okay, so I need someone to suspend the rules to have the new business item added?
Sure.
So do you want to pass the chair to somebody?
Sure. Can I pass the chair to somebody? Cindy, you want to take the chair?
Sure.
Given that it was asked, has the department seen it? I have seen the motion. There is a part two to that motion, though, that refers to providing some descriptors of benefits, getting that wording, but it had to do with sort of quantifying the benefits.
Could we bring it forward during the active transportation?
Do you want to look at it more and work on it more, or?
That part of it, I'm not exactly sure how that would fit with the quantification of those, the different categories, because that becomes a different type of commentary and whatnot, and I'm not sure what kind of work we would have to do with our consultants to have them. I mean, many of them have that expertise, but we haven't had a chance to talk to them about what this would mean to them. Number two in that motion.
But do you want, Madam Chair, do you want to bring it back, maybe, to, we can...
Because this is a directive to do, right? What about asking them to look at, like, this is what information you would like. How do you...
So you're worried about, number two, whether the project will have an overall positive, negative, or neutral impact for each of the four main modes. So you're saying that's probably subjective, would require analysis, would require...
When you get into that type of analysis, you can't have it just randomly coming from,
eight
consulting firms and a couple of internal people.
So I'd be fine to drop number two and to move it the way it is. With that, and that would give us a simplified budget breakdown that indicates the dollar amount for improvements being invested for the following. Is that? We could do that?
We can do that if we know in advance.
Right. Okay, perfect. I'd like to make that motion. Drop number two. And we can pursue that at a later point if we want.
Okay.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Okay, all those in favor?
So we're doing the motion now? Is that what we're doing? Or we're moving his...
moving your motion. We suspended the rules. You passed the chair over to Councilor Gilroy.
Perfect. Okay.
So it's your motion.
Okay. So I'd like to move the motion.
And when
please.
We say all reports, is it this sort of report or other reports, this effects, Brad?
Transportation reports. Yeah. Anything related to transportation.
Well, it isn't. Okay. So just to be clear, my expectation is that when we bring this report forward next year, we would have that breakdown.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. That,
yeah.
And the regional, like when we do the regional.
We do that anyways.
We do it anyways. Yeah. That's right. So we do it anyways with the regional.
So if we could be specific to when we provide the 2016 version of this report, that would be helpful.
Because this is a bigger animal right now, the way it's written.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the rest of it would look, because we don't, in the regional and local program, we don't report separately on...
But there's other transportation projects that we do, other road transportation projects that aren't in regional and that aren't in local.
They can be standalone
projects. So I'd like the standalones, but they're not regional.
But they don't come as a separate report
typically
because through the capital budget process, dollars are assigned to it, and it's
that.
In bits and pieces, preliminary detail, and finally the capital construction. So
if we put a dollar value on it, then like it's just that there's countless opportunities that I know have been missed over the years This helps look at, when we're doing road projects, that we look at this and that it's transparent and open, that if we're spending, you know, more than X amount of dollars, that we're including, that we are identifying and that we're recognizing that we're incorporating that in.
From the perspective of being able to capture what you're looking for, reporting in this report would be the most effective way to do that.
But like you say, through the capital budget process, other things are in it that aren't in regionals, that aren't in local, that are separate projects, that, you know, it's those ones I'd like to capture too in this, in the essence of this.
Yes, and through the capital budget, the documents that are produced, you'll know that there's a lot of service-based budget information, there's a lot of statistics in there. That would be the place to perhaps add another comparator that speaks to those kinds of things, whether it was global or, you know, in other words, covering all of the transportation, which would by default include the local.
Right?
Well, this would be specifically for the local.
Well, no, but the way it's written now covers all. The way it written is now covers all.
Right. So the opportunity for that, if it was this report where it's covering, in this case, the $60 million worth, would be a place that we can bundle it through the process that we've talked about. We'd get the word out to the consultants and to our own staff that we're going to need to report back on this. From the bigger picture, I think the best way to do that, because we don't come with a separate report, would be to talk about, and I don't know exactly what it would look like because it's not us that compiles it, it's done corporately. But there are statistics that are included in the preambles to the budget that talk about the different services and different outcomes and performance measures.
But it doesn't tie it to the projects, though. That doesn't tie it to the projects. That doesn't have the consultant or whoever check off those boxes and provide that report back.
No, because it's not a report, it's the budget.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. So there really isn't another.
It would just mean more reports, is what it would mean.
It would
that's
mean
what
we're
you're
creating
saying.
A whole bunch of reports that.
How many do you think that would
exist?
Be?
Well, if you look at the regional street program, mm-hmm.
But in the regional street program, they're identified. But some, yes.
In a given year?
That's
probably
right.
12, 15?
12, so it would mean 12 or 15 more reports.
Which is monstrous. As a start, we can manage this report, augmenting that and providing the breakdown. I'm not sure how it would work for the regional individually for those streets because we don't produce individual reports.
I'm wondering, should we have maybe them report back on how we can do that? We'll keep it on maybe the agenda for the next meeting, but maybe we can figure out, you know, a good way of reporting back.
On the 12 or 15 or so that are in the budget, in the capital budget, how you could report back on those?
Yeah, and if it was worrying to the effect that directed us to provide the breakdown for next year's version of this mm-hmm. report, and that we report back.
That's for this one, right? That's for these
that's
right here.
These.
But let's talk
that
about the other ones.
We report back on the viability of providing a similar breakdown on the rest of the transportation related expenditures, then we could look at, well, what might be possible.
Sure. And when would you bring that back then? Reporting back on the viability of reporting on the ones that are approved in the capital budget that aren't.
Well, given that nothing essentially will change until the next cycle, October-ish thing, September?
Yeah, no, we can look at that first.
Because, we're starting to wind down the projects.
Yeah.
So October,
and they would all
October,
be, maybe start finishing some of
those. That would be great. Sure, that's a great compromise.
We'll
get a sense.
We'll
lay it over the
Well, we're going to put this motion forward on these particular, on the local streets.
Which one?
On, we're going to put this forward because we...
So there's a motion on the table right now.
Motion on the table that this motion be applied to the capital local street renewals, alley renewals, Timbuktu, Minnesota Relays, granular roadway improvements program. Correct? Is that correct? The wording of that program. So that's what this motion is for. That, because they do reports back on these.
So we're going to ask them to include those items in this report for next year.
Yeah.
Is what your motion, your so, item one will say.
So this line will change.
Is that okay? And then that administration can report back. So this is, what is this, another motion? No, it's
well, are you making it a number two in this motion then? To ask them to report back in
on
regards
the
to
the
liability of lines and what breaks down for the remainder of the transportation related capital expenditure.
Okay. And then that way we have our regionals covered, we have the ones approved in the capital budget, and we have these covered. Yeah, that's great. Okay.
I think about it some more, but we can do that.
Yeah, it's very hard to do it off the cuff. It's better off to be able to sit back and see what the reports actually contain so that you can determine what you can grab from them.
Well, yes, because but there are no reports on those ones, though, the ones that are approved in the capital budget.
So I think Sean's talking about the all the process with the consultants and see what they're able to do.
Okay, information. Okay, that was the motion. Okay, all those in favor? Janice, or you should move. Sorry. Oh, sorry, I guess you should move. She moved. Yeah, I know, I did. I moved it to you. All those in favor? Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carried. Okay. And now let's move the capital local street renewals, alley renewals, TBOs, granular roadway improvements. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Item number 18, amendment of 2014 capital budget. Adopt a capital budget to include additional funding. This is great, from various donations. This is really good.
Yes. So moved.
Okay. So moved. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Item number 19, this is appointment of a weed inspector under the Noxious Weed Act.
It's actually a number of inspectors, and it's something that we're required to do.
Of weed inspectors, yes.
Yeah. They've been by the background what it's all about. It is a requirement to do
Yeah, under the Noxious Weed Act, we must appoint these. We haven't in the recent years because we have a pretty good act that's called, or a bylaw called the Neighborhood Livability Bylaw that really covers it off. So it's really just a matter of process here.
Yep. No, that's great. Someone like to move this?
I move.
Okay. All in favor? Contrary? Aye. Carried.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is a great program here. Okay, great program. This is new. This is okay. Do you want do you want him to speak to it? Are we all familiar? We're all familiar with that. This is the efficiencies that Mayor Bowman set out to seek, and he found $6.5 million. And these projects are $6.5 million are the projects that are happening because of the efficiencies, and they're all desperately needed, as many more projects are desperately needed, but these four were priority projects. Any questions of Mr. Satcher on this at all or anything?
So Brad, we need to sole source just to get going right away on them.
Yeah. At this time of the year, typically we would have all the engineering done, we'd already be to tendering and whatnot. We're starting from square one.
A little bit later.
With these, so typically consulting procurement process is a 2 to 3 month process. We'll miss this construction season, so we're asking to allow us to negotiate on a single source basis. It still means that the consultants who we have asked to submit an individual proposal, they still have to do that. We still negotiate the fees, we still negotiate who's going to be on the job, and it has to be acceptable to us. So we use our knowledge of what's best for the the delivery of these types of projects to negotiate with the consultants and get a fair price and an appropriate scope of work.
Yeah. So even though it's sole source, there's still a process in place that we follow. Yeah.
Okay.
And maybe just to one of the questions when I looked at this initially, project number three, the regional pavement improvements for the airport vicinity, those projects, or this project, it's not going to end up costing more to get it done in the time frame that we're looking at.
No, it's actually the type of work that we're going to do there is in fact more of what we've already done on a section of Wellington last year. It's a type of maintenance overlay where it's a thick overlay that our projections, you know, we originally projected we would get, you know, 5 or 7 years. It looks like we'll get more years out of this type of treatment. We're using it more and more to reestablish drainage and ride. And we've already done a section of Wellington on the way into the airport, so we want to do the rest of Wellington and as well Sargent coming out of the airport. It's one of those situations where those roads are in really tough shape. We've got a lot of really good things happening in the city this summer, and the Grey Cup and FIFA in June, July. So we want to get in there, do this. This is not ripping the streets apart and getting caught in the weather and then having construction zones for these folks to go through. Our intention is, if this is approved in anticipation of approval, we will be ready to go once it's approved. And be in and out before the visitors come.
Okay.
Need suspension of the rules for the service.
Oh, we know, oh, because it's
an addendum.
All
yeah.
right, so I have to suspend the rules for this item. All in favor? Okay, contrary carried. And now we'll move the item. Would someone like to move the item? Go for it, Sean. Okay, Councillor Thompson. All right.
That beautiful street on that needs to be fixed.
Exactly. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Okay, and could I have someone move to consent agenda and adjourn?
So moved.
All right. All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Thank you. And thus ends the meeting.
All right.
Excellent. All right. Perfect. Can I have one more question?
One question.
Yeah.